Hi and welcome back to my channel, and today I'm going to talk about something that I have spoken in parts before, and it is about disruption, but I'm going to approach it a bit differently this time around. And I'm going to approach it from the lens of innovation and how, and I'm going to kind of elaborate on how innovation and the very nature of innovation has changed in the last few decades. Consequently, their innovation as a process, which was a cash-rich, talent-rich process, is becoming more and more widespread, as a result of which, and with the proliferation of technologies, it has opened up new avenues of risk of incumbent companies. Now, this on the 2nd of January 2022, I posted a video on incumbent responses to digital disruption. Those of who are interested on this subject can see this video as a precursor to this one, the links of which I'm going to post in the comments section of this video. Now, if you like the content of the video, do share a like button or subscribe to the channel. That would help people, that would help more and more people accessing these contents, and would kind of help organizations to plan for their future. With that, let me kind of go back, kind of take you to the slide, to the presentation. And here goes. Just a second as the slide comes up. Yeah, so the presentation is titled Responding to the Threats of Neo Innovation, in which I'm going to talk about, introduce disruption as a concept. And I've spoken about disruption, but I thought it's important to give a definition of disruption. Now, this is my definition based on my experiences, and there might be certain academic moorings to it, but it is not the only definition of disruption. And also, as an add-on, how innovation has changed over the years, its implications on industry structure. From there, I'm going to abstract the incumbent's response to disruption in a mature industry with an example, and then from there on, talk about our learnings from that particular example. Now, disruption has been loosely talked about as any change in industry structure. And with a product innovation, people talk about disruption with a lot of ease. But for me, a disruption happens where there is a permanent impairment to the existing industry structure, which is the entire value chain has been morphed into a new normal, and it is going to be changed forever. Consequently, to the impairment of the industry structure, there has to be change in the underlying economics of goods and services induced by a process of innovation which is premised on scalable technologies. So the first thing is a permanent impairment, which is a complete change in the existing industry structure. Consequent to the change, it is evidence in the form of the change in underlying economics of how goods and services are sold. And this happens through a process of innovation using technologies which are mature. Disruption is done not necessary when new products are introduced or incumbent business models are challenged. Again, as I said, this is my definition of disruption, but for me, disruption is a much wider phenomena and not a change in a product or a process innovation or a fall of an incumbent organization, however big or dominant it might be. With that, let me kind of move on to explain to you how innovation models over the periods have changed and what, as a result of this change in innovation processes, is creating a significant disruption as per this definition in most industries. Now, then the first pass is top-down, which is expensive replacement. Where new markets were created top-down, innovators created differentiated goods targeted to customers who could afford the same and willing to pay for this merchandise. Due to economies of scale, these goods would later trickle down to mass markets in the form of similar or scaled-down versions of the original products at lower prices. Now, this happens all the time in consumer electronics, in auto and logistics, supply chain models, and so on and so forth. The second significant one, which was championed by Professor Clayton Christensen, the father of innovation, whose work, who argued that disruption often works, disruptors work bottom up, which means typically cheaper products in underserved or ignored segments of a particular market are given a cheaper product, and these cheaper products are often ignored by incumbents. So it's a product is cheap, it is only for the lower end of the market, and over time these innovators become better and improve the price performance ratios and get into the mainstream and disrupt the incumbents. Now there is a whole theory around it which talks about cheaper inferior alternatives mainstreamed over time, and Professor Christiansen's theory is very is robust in a sense that it's grounded with multiple examples, and many things in innovation could have been explained by it. So that was the second big movement in the innovation models. The third one was the blue ocean, where innovators stop thinking of traditional products and competitors altogether and come to you sideways. Now examples of it is Hilti, where a product is sold as a service, or John Deere, where using my John Deere from a farm equipment manufacturer, it became an end-to-end service providers to its customers, or Caterpillars, which created an ecosystem where it sold the cat through its application, the Cat Connect, and an ecosystem that it built. It did not sell its product as a product, but it sold it as a service. Now this is the orthogonal innovation. You will see it in Michelin, in Talking Tires, and so on and so forth. Pretty standard right now, where innovators come in sideways, right? The final one is called the Big Bang Disruption, which is based on a book written by Larry Downes and Paul Nunes. In this book, disruptors attack existing markets, not just from top or bottom or sideways, but from all three quadrants at the same time. By tying their products to exponential growth, exponential technologies, and falling costs of new technologies, their offerings can simultaneously be better, cheaper, and more customized, and not only for a particular group of customers, which Christiansen argued, but for everybody. This isn't disruptive innovation. This is actually devastating. So in the Big Bang Disruptor, the innovator is not targeting your higher-end customer with a premium alternative. Neither is he stripping down a mature product into its components and giving different parts of it at affordable prices, or deconstructing existing products, right, and pitching them to a new market. A disruptor in a Big Bang Disruption scenario is tossing something towards your customer and hoping to attract them to do business that has been completely different than yours. I mean, think of the example of Twitter. When a Twitter was created, it did not want to disrupt existing news channels or existing media houses, but it landed up becoming the most interactive platform where news and other kinds of content was shared. Now that is a significant disruption. Right now this kind of disruption has been timed. This comes to vogue because there is cost of technology has come down, and the cost of experimentation has also come down significantly, and there are organizations that are creating open innovation. Now let me kind of explain this with an example. In the world of digital, artificial intelligence, or incumbency in artificial intelligence, is a purview, or the research around artificial intelligence is restricted to big tech companies, because it requires huge amount of dollars and it's a long gestation process. Therefore, I mean, the Google brains of the world who have bought over DeepMind, the Facebook AI labs, Microsoft, Apple do significant research and spend huge amount of dollars, as much as Uber does it. So therefore, it's restricted to a class of companies. Now, if it was restricted to a class of companies, then the innovation, the cost of innovation, the products coming out of these processes would obviously be very, very expensive. And it would not be in the reach of smaller enterprises. Now, what really happened over a period of time, when artificial intelligence was moving into artificial general intelligence as a subject, organizations like OpenAI, which was funded by researchers backed by Elon Musk and people of that kind, created a movement where their research would be given for free from anybody, from Bombay to Burkina Faso, from Matunga to Melbourne to Access, creating a larger user base at a zero cost thing. Similarly, to give you another specific example, Google has created, Before I get into the Google example, artificial intelligence and deep neural networks is an evolving field of artificial intelligence. And with more data, deep neural networks and its applications and its use cases are becoming more and more prevalent. So people who are in convoluted neural networks on deep learning theories are the ones who are going to actually create disproportionate value for themselves. Now, to be able to do so, you need a platform and a research ability of a very different order. Now, what Google has done is to create a mass movement around deep neural network, created this tool or a platform called TensorFlow. Now, TensorFlow as a platform already has predefined code where you can train your deep neural networks with data and create outcomes much faster than if you were to do the research on your own. Now, to give you an example of the application of TensorFlow, on the right hand side, you will see an MIT open courseware on deep learning where they are using TensorFlow to teach students on not how to write code, but how to use already canned code to their advantage and to be able to use it in large scale. Therefore, without investing billions of dollars, which the deep tech do it, you could actually compete by using tools and open source code tools or outputs of OpenAI or TensorFlow to scale up technologies which were beyond the reach of the common citizen, right? Or smaller enterprises. As a consequence of this, the process of innovation or Big Bang innovation, like Downs and Nunes talked about in their book, is becoming more and more all-pervasive, ubiquitous, and more people are jumping in. As a result of which, a lot of young people trained in these technologies actually do not go after your product. They actually create something which is a new technology use case. Your product or the service that you are an incumbent is merely a casualty. That is the beauty of the innovation of today. So as against the classical innovation models, which was premised on trying to replicate your product or make your product better, offer a cheaper version of a product or even a premium version of the product, depending upon where the disruptor would come in, the new innovation models are premised in using are not attacking a particular technology or a product. They are putting a technology in place where consumers across different layers of your segment are gravitating, thereby creating a thereby creating chaos for the incumbent. Now let us kind of understand this as an example. I'll kind of give you an example of a mapping as an industry, which is a mature and a very old industry. Typically, mapping or navigational maps were dominated by very few players. I mean, they were dominated by Rand McNally, Thomas Guides, and the likes who could geographically map all routes in the world. The initial threat obviously came from free internet-based maps and driving directions, which many of us who are my generation could know of MapQuest and Yahoo, which were digital maps where users could zoom in and overlay them with satellite photos. That was step one. Completely dominated, mature industry, few players. What happened next was that with the proliferation of technology in those days, in the mid-90s, high precision data from GPS were created to create this in-dash devices, which were standalone devices, and companies like Garmin, TomTom, Magellan competed fiercely by offering products which were tagged onto your vehicle or to your car, a passenger vehicle or a commercial vehicle, to do the navigation. The time was either towards luxury products. These were luxury products which were then over time became more commoditized, which was step one of which is the top-down disruption that I talked in my previous slide. Now, happened subsequently, the true disruptor, which is the power of the smartphone, became ubiquitous, and the smartphone became a disruptor, a device which was neither designed nor intended to compete with navigational maps. And Google navigational maps were launched in 2009 as a smartphone-based technology application. Google included its navigation maps as a part of its standard release of its new versions of the Android operating system, making it available to millions. Google Maps were offered free in exchange for permission to present more adverts to users, which was its main business. Now, manufacturing distribution costs are low for Google Maps, and it was based on reusable information and indirect sources of revenue. So Google Maps did not have to generate money on its own. It was an add-on to its advertising business. So Google Maps, for users, the maps virtually added nothing to the cost of ownership and was maintained on the device. For its competitors, which was the Garmin's and the TomToms, the app-based service operated in a completely different model. Before the apps showed up, the Garmin's and TomToms developed a robust business model in making and selling standalone devices that perform the same function. When Google released its navigation maps into the cloud, traditional devices were still selling well, and Google was not looking to disrupt the business of these companies. The app, however, outperformed the standalone navigational device on every competitive dimension and did better by keeping the mapping data and road calculation in the cloud, making it easy to continuously update them and improve them. Now, the question is, how did the Garmin's and the TomToms of the world respond? Now, the Garmin's and the TomToms of the world understood that it would not be able to compete with this technology on a standalone basis. Therefore, what it did was it redeployed its existing technology to a completely different use case and moved away into wearables, and subsequently with the multiple launch of multiple cases, it became a sports and a fitness manufacturer, as against staying in the same thing and trying to fight it out with Google Maps, which was free. Similarly, TomTom moved away from its retail navigation business and handheld devices to specialized use cases in auto navigation, fleet management and logistics, and creating a completely new segment, as did Magellan, where it built B2B niches in fleet management, commercial fleet navigation, off-roader navigators, which was not a specialty for the Google Maps, and therefore carved out niches of its own. So the learning from there is, when the Big Bang disruption comes at you, it is free to the consumer, and it is probably better quality, as the Google Maps example proved. It is cheaper and more effective. Therefore, to be able to compete against them, you have to recognize where the Big Bang disruption is going to happen to you from outside your industry, consequently steer away from it. Either you actually modify your product to kind of slow down the impact of the disruption, or steer away into another sector where your technology can be repurposed and has an alternative use, just as like the Garmin's of the world did. Now think about it. It was a navigational in-dash system from where it used the same technology to become a fitness and a sports and a fitness wearables company much ahead of the iWatch. And most runners, like my friends who are into running, use the Garmin watch. And not only runners, cyclists, swimmers, and so on and so forth. So the learning from here is, be aware of when the Big Bang disruption is coming at you, and it's going to come from sources that is not the ones that you generally look at. It's not going to come from the competitive space that you're aware of. Once it happens, do something to slow it down, or use your technology and IP. Do not fight that battle, because you're not going to be fighting them, because they come for almost free to the consumers. They are significantly cheaper. They become significantly cheaper at a good quality. So what do you possibly could do is to look at alternative uses of the technology, which is what the Garmin's, the TomToms, and the Magellan's showed. And that requires a lot of creativity and being focused on the subject before your entire enterprise goes down. Hope you like this video. Do share, like, and comment as you deem fit, and I will come back to you soon. And do share it. Any feedback is welcome, and wishing you all a very good day. See you soon in my next presentation. Bye-bye.